say in the back, I think I can hear earlier, so I'm going to shout so that you can hear me. First of all, it's an honor to be here with my colleagues. I hope there will be more of these kinds of gatherings in a lot of different kinds of professions. It's time. It's time for us to do that and express ourselves. And I think Nathan Truth's words and Mike Williams' words, especially get a few on this really interesting to me, which was find a common language. It's there. And up there on that wall it says, blend Indigenous and Western planning tools. We're in a unique position to be able to do that. I've noticed on the title of my program it said, creating places that incorporate both the practical and the spiritual, heightening human sensitivity to cultural and environmental issues. What that is that it says, stand in our ways and beliefs. Listen, stand in our ways and beliefs. Let's see if I can get organized here now, but run this stuff. In planning and design, there's a lot of areas that we can get into. And is this a worthwhile profession for future communities that we're developing? Can American Indigenous planners and designers have one foot in the non-Indian Indigenous world and one foot in the Indigenous world and not go crazy? It might be helpful for Indigenous professionals to remember the ways and beliefs of our ancestors and our elders. Our ancestors have passed on to us many things that we can use to solve current planning and design problems. This is not an easy thing to do. There are many things that work at keeping us from listening to our ancestors and our elders. That was me a long time ago. I was the only American Indian student in the School of Architecture and Planning at the University of Oregon back in the 60s. One of the requirements of study at the School of Architecture was to take a 3 times a week, 2-year course on the history of world architecture and planning. Not once during the entire 2 years did the professor show or talk about the history of American Indigenous architecture. Not once. We mainly studied the great architecture and planning of Europe and the Middle East and Asia and modern America. And as a young American Indian studying the history of architecture, I was not given a complete picture. There are some really magnificent ancient structures all over Alaska. All of the whole 48 that our ancestors built. Communities, not just architecture, but communities. A lot of these ancient structures have not even been uncovered, let alone restored. We have been here a long, long time. We have a deep history in this place. There is not a place in America without an Indigenous story. We know every habitat. We know every plant. We know every animal. We know every bit of the water. We know ice. We know dirt. We know the rocks. We know the sky. We know the wind. We know the rain. And we know the smell of everything. We know the spirit of all things around us. However, much of what our ancestors have left us is verbal. So there's a lot of architecture, a lot of paintings, a lot of art. But really the biggest part of what our ancestors and elders have given us is all verbal. It was passed down through many generations. Stories from experience. These verbal stories are the most important things for us to listen to. These are the things that can help us stand in two worlds. These are the things that we can use in our planning and design efforts. We can bring them to the table to help solve problems. Before I show you what my Indigenous family gave me as a gift to help solve difficult problems, there are some things I just wanted to mention that I think are really important to remember. Secondly, we are still here. We have survived. Even though the American